Hello, and welcome to Gateway Alliance. If you're joining us live, we're glad that you're with us this morning. If you're watching the recording later on, thanks for checking us out. Here we are again. I think this is week number six or so that we are doing this. It still feels very strange to not have our regular Gateway family here with us. But by doing this, we've been able to have some friends that would not be able to gather with us, able to tune in. And so whoever you are, wherever you are, we're glad that you're with us today. This is still a time of worship, and so we invite you to worship with us. We're going to have some songs again. The layout is going to be the same, but if you can, please join in with the singing. Feel free to stand up wherever you are. Stand up if you would like and join in with the singing. This is such a blessing for us to be able to continue to have these times together, even though it's strange and different, but to be able to still raise our voices together, even though we are separated, being able to have times of focused prayer and message with one another, this is a blessing for us. So if wherever you're at home with family members, by yourself, whatever the case may be, this is a time for us to connect with our God. And so let's try our best to do that. One thing that we do need for sure is help. And so let's open with prayer and ask God to be present with us and to participate with us today. So join me in prayer, please. Heavenly Father, as we begin another live stream service this morning, Father, we thank you for the opportunity of it. We thank you that it's available and that we can do this. But Father, we again confess our need of you and of help. And so help us to never try to get away from you during these moments. Focus our minds, focus our attention on you this morning, and may you be glorified and honored. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you. me. Thank you.
that song. That was fantastic. If you're unfamiliar with that song, I would invite you to search out some history behind that song, because it's a beautiful song, and for Christians, we find a lot of hope in that song, especially during difficult times. But that song was written from a place of deep grief and great sorrow, and so I invite you to search it out, look for some of the history behind it, and just learn a little bit more about that song. Have you ever been part of a victory parade? It's a phenomenon that we have here in the States, at least, especially with our professional sports teams. Right, they have championships, and if they win, then they get to have this parade. Even the high school here in Plymouth, in the town where we're located, if the football team will win, the high school football team, if they win the championship, the fire engines go through town blasting the sirens. The first time that I heard it, I thought a major tragedy had struck, and it was just a celebration. Right, and so I'm sure you've seen this if you've not been part of it. Things can get absolutely wild, right? Things can get crazy at some of these parades, especially with the sports teams, where they're just celebrating this victory. And it, in a sense, it makes sense. Why wouldn't you celebrate, right? The victors get to walk around and talk trash, struts, show off a little bit, right? And nobody really says anything. Of course, the losing team looks at it and says, oh, how dare they, right? Like, but if you're part of the winning team or even regionally close, then you're going to try to join in, right? And it makes sense to us to do this. But we just came out of Easter, right? Last week was Easter Sunday. For us as Christians, this is the greatest victory that can ever be achieved. There is no greater victory than Jesus leaving the tomb alive, right? This is victory that we celebrate on that Sunday. If you're unfamiliar with the story from what Scripture says, or if you do know it really well, I want you to try and forget that you know the story really well. What would you imagine would come next in the written account of Jesus coming out of the tomb? Remember, this is a victory of universal parameters. This covers the entire universe, not just one nation in our one world. This goes throughout everything. Doesn't it almost seem as though there should be a parade? Right? That the disciples are running around. They're the winning team. That they should be running around, going up to the Roman authorities and talking trash. Like, what are you going to do now? What can you do? Our guy, he just came back from the dead. Yeah, you're Rome, you're kind of scary, but not anymore. Right? We're going up to the religious leaders who were so instrumental in getting Jesus onto that cross and just kind of saying, what are you going to do now? We are victorious. We're throwing this parade. It's fascinating that Scripture kind of will always lead us in a direction that we don't always expect. Scripture, the Bible, is God's word. This is God's message to us. And so when we're reading through the Bible, while he used human authors and we can see this humanness through it, it is his message to us. These are the things that he wants us to know about him and about the world and about our condition and some history and all. Everything that's in there is there purposefully for us to know for some reason. And if you spend more time with it, you'll find yourself surprised by it. You'll find yourself amazed by reading through something and thinking, I can guess of what's going to come next. And then when you get to that part, it was something completely and totally different from what you were expecting. What we see throughout Scripture is not propaganda. It's not this message about God of where it's all just this political lying. It's not full of falseness, of where when you read something, you think, oh man, now, I'm a Christian, and I've been a Christian for a really long time, and so I might have a slightly different view than some other people. But if you really spend time with it, you'll see it differently than a lot of other books that are written, or that in a way that it could be written. What we find is this human aspect through it. The Psalms are fantastic. The Psalms are a collection of poems, hymns, that are in the Old Testament. And there's one in particular that is different from all the rest of them. And I want to read it for us this morning. If you haven't, I would invite you to spend time with the Psalms, especially during this time of the difficulty that we find ourselves in, because they really tap in to a lot of the emotions that we deal with. The psalm I'm going to read for us today is Psalm 88. Now, I'm going to read it from a paraphrase that's called The Message. I'm reading it purposefully from this today because there's some language that is used in here that I think you're going to be able to connect with from what's happening in our everyday life. Now, if you have a Bible of a different translation, then I would invite you to read it from that translation as well. But I want us to hear this psalm, Psalm 88, from this translation, this paraphrase called The Message. So listen close and just listen for this humanness that is here. God, you're my last chance of the day. I spend the night on my knees before you. Put me on your salvation agenda. Take notes on the trouble I'm in. I've had my fill of trouble. I'm camped on the edge of hell. I'm written off as a lost cause. One more statistic, a hopeless case. Abandoned as already dead. One more body in a stack of corpses. And not so much as a gravestone. I'm a black hole in oblivion. You've dropped me into a bottomless pit, sunk me in a pitch black abyss. I'm battered, senseless by your rage, relentlessly pounded by your waves of anger. You turned my friends against me, made me horrible to them. I'm caught in a maze and can't find my way out. Blinded by tears of pain and frustration, I call to you, God, all day I call. I wring my hands, I plead for help. Are the dead a live audience for your miracles? Do ghosts ever join the choirs that praise you? Does your love make any difference in a graveyard? Is your faithful presence noted in the corridors of hell? Are your marvelous wonders ever seen in the dark? Your righteous ways noticed in the land of no memory? I'm standing my ground, God, shouting for help. At my prayers every morning, on my knees each daybreak. Why, God, do you turn a deaf ear? Why do you make yourself scarce? For as long as I remember, I've been hurting. I've taken the worst you can hand out, and I've had it. Your wildfire anger has blazed through my life. I'm bleeding black and blue. You've attacked me fiercely from every side, raining down blows till I'm nearly dead. You made lover and neighbor alike dump me. The only friend I have left is darkness. Is there anything with that you can resonate with today? Earlier this week, when I was reading through this, I got to the part about wringing my hands, and I thought, my goodness, we've all been wringing our hands by washing them so much and using sanitizer and so forth. Constantly we're wringing our hands, and it just resonated with me so much. This psalm, it doesn't get much more human than this. Right? It's different. The psalm is different. And there's almost an unexpected aspect that this would be allowed in Scripture if God operated in a way that made sense to us. See, most psalms will have some sort of transition in them. Many of them were written, just like this one, from a place of deep grief, darkness, uncertainty. But almost all of the other ones will have some sort of transition in them. They will start out dark, but then go to light, or they'll start out light and then move to this deep question or this kind of more dark place. But with 88, we don't see that. We don't see that at all. We just see this lament. Just this outpour of grief, saying these things that, in a sense, aren't even exactly right, but yet it's allowed to stay in. It's there for us to read through and to see this author, this real person who wrote this, how much they were struggling. God allows us to see this. He gives space for expression. He gives space for lament. He gives space for these hard questions. I find that refreshing, and I find it beautiful, and I find it encouraging for us as we just continue on in this unknown period of our time. There's some hope out there, right? That we're going to be able to return to some sort of normalcy, whatever that will look like. But yet, we're not yet there. What I find good, beneficial, helpful about this psalm, about Scripture, is that it's not robotic. It's not machine-like. You see, and I don't think that God is interested in machines as far as mass-produced disciples, mass-produced followers, where we all look exactly the same. I think there's space for some differences, for us to look a little bit differently. And we can see this throughout the text, that it's not just a stamp approach of, okay, you look exactly like this now. There was a few years ago, more than a few, but within the last decade, the family and I, we were flying somewhere. I don't remember where we were, what airport we were at, or where we were going, but we were at the gate of the airport. We were waiting for our flight, and Chrissy and I, at this time we only had JL and Addie, but Chrissy and I had flown, we had all flown multiple times. Chrissy and I had flown to other countries. We had always landed safely, but we had experienced some rough flights. There was times of where we had gone through some pretty rough experiences, but we always had landed safely. As we're sitting at the gate waiting to be able to board the plane, there was a young lady sitting close to us. And it was obvious she was extremely nervous. We struck up a conversation with her, and what we found out was that this was about to be her first flight. She was about to walk onto the same airplane as we were, and this was going to be her very first experience on an airplane. Well, we did what most other people will do. We softened the truth. We tried to calm her down. We had all of this knowledge in the back of our minds of things that we had gone through, but the prevailing wisdom for us, at least in our country, is don't tell everything you know, right? Keep some things to yourself. Yeah, they're going to experience it, but maybe let them experience it on their own. I've kind of come to regret some of that at times, because what we do is we endanger people. We told her, well, we've gone on flights. Yeah, we've had some tough times, but it's always worked out fine. We were here now, right? We're about to go on another airplane, so it hasn't scared us away. We're going to be fine. Everything is going to be fine. We boarded the plane. We take off. It wasn't fine. It was a rough flight. I couldn't see the young lady from where I was sitting. In fact, I never saw her again. But while I was going on that flight, I was wondering, how is she doing? Because this is not a good flight for your first experience. This is horrible, right? This is frightening. Spoiler alert, we did land safely, right? But it was indeed a very rough flight. I endangered her by making it too robotic, making it too machine-like. What if we turn the Easter story into a machine? What if we lose the humanness that goes on in the Easter story? What if we make it something that is so sterile that it doesn't have smell to it anymore? It doesn't have a realness to it anymore. I think we run the risk of endangerment. The rest of the story is fascinating. And if you're unfamiliar with it, I would invite you to find a Bible app or a paper Bible and read in the Gospels the rest of the story. They are all a little bit different, but the whole story is there. What would you expect to come next? Again, is there going to be this huge, massive celebration, this huge, massive parade? What Scripture tells us, it's the absolute opposite. There is no parade that takes place. Jesus has come out of the tomb. He's living. He's victorious. The winning team, his disciples, are hiding. They're hiding because they're filled with fear. And I think there's a sense of where that's totally understandable. It's easy for us to read this story and to think, well, if I was there, I would be completely different. Let's be really honest for a moment. No, we wouldn't. Because when we really dive into it and imagine what it was really like to the best that we can with the knowledge that we have, we would be hiding as well. Because what the witnesses saw Jesus go through, to the human mind, there's no coming back from this. And they were his followers, so there's fear that they would be next, that Rome and the religious leaders were going to be hunting them down, arresting them, and doing the exact same thing to them that they did to Jesus. We're seeing this humanness in this story. The disciples and the group that is around them, they were traumatized. How could you not be? Seeing this inhumane, this horrific torture and death, it would, in fact, leave you traumatized. And I think it would lead you, if you were there in person, to lament. To a place of asking questions and saying things that you have no understanding of, that you have no ability to actually be able to answer. Jesus spent time meeting with his disciples, he would show up in a way that he had never done before. He was doing things that he had not done previously. And some of his disciples had seen him and some had not. And so there was all of this conversation that was taking place. Well, do you remember this? Did you see this? Imagine the questions that would be asked from the ones that hadn't seen him yet. What do you mean you saw him? I saw him too. I saw what they did to him. There's no way anybody comes back from that. Imagine all the questions. We can tap into that a little bit right now, I think. How many questions have you asked about this pandemic that we're living in? And if we're honest, how many answers do we really actually have? The disciples are struggling. It's easy for us to think they could be celebrating, but they're not. They're struggling. There's one disciple in particular who kind of, everything falls on him because of what's written in the Gospel of John. I'm going to read it here in a couple of moments. His name is Thomas. Thomas is called very often Doubting Thomas, which is incredibly unfair, I think, to this man. But we have this account in the Gospel of John, and it is beautiful. It's sad. It's encouraging. It's incredible. Here's how John writes it in the Gospel of John, chapter 20. Now Thomas, one of the 12, called the twin, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see in his hands the mark of the nails, and place my finger into the mark of the nails, and place my hand into his side, I will never believe." 8 days later, his disciples were inside again, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands. And put your hand and place it in my side. Do not disbelieve, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." Here's what I find beautiful about this, is that I can place myself here. Imagine you in Thomas's place. This is such a human response here that Thomas has. His friends, these guys that he's been hanging out with for years at this point now, we're telling him, "We've seen Jesus. He is living." And Thomas just has this reaction. "There's no way that I can believe this." And to his credit, that's a credible response. The crucifixion was absolutely horrific. Other than God doing this, there's no way that you come back to life 3 days later from this type of execution. Thomas is emoting. He's just crying out. Have you ever done this? Have you ever said something in a moment of where, if I won't believe it unless I can do this? Such a human response. And 8 days later, this is incredible, the amount of time that's allowed to pass by. Again, Jesus allows time to pass. He's moving slowly, by what I would expect anyway. Then all of a sudden, he's there. He's there in the room with him. He's standing. He wasn't dragged in by anybody else. He wasn't carried in. He appeared in this room. He's standing. He's alive. He's speaking. There's a couple instances of where he ate in front of the disciples to prove to them that he wasn't some sort of ghost-like figure. He was back fully in the flesh. He turns his attention to Thomas. And he gives space for this. He recognizes, he calls to mind what Thomas has said and tells him, place your finger here. Place your hand in my side. It was the spear wound in which, after he was dead, the Roman soldier took a spear and thrust it into his heart to make sure that he was dead. This was a fulfilling of prophecy, that no bone would be broken, but that he would be pierced. Thomas cries out, my Lord and my God. It's a beautiful moment together. And we see this acceptance now. We see this understanding. We see almost in a sense Thomas saying, I don't need to do that because now I see you. Now I believe. Jesus gives this incredible message, really, I think, for us today to rest in. Blessed are we that we can believe without seeing him. That's good news for us today. We're seeing this humanness in this story. We're not seeing this massive parade of celebration, of getting even. We're seeing Jesus, God the Father, working in a way that we don't expect. We've kind of been looking at this by and Thomas. Let's look at Jesus a little bit more. Again, Jesus is standing. He's alive. He's come out of the tomb. He's defeated death and sin. He is victorious. He is champion of the universe. There is no one that can say, hey, let's have a rematch. There is no going back on this. This is a one-time event. The victory stands for all eternity. But what I find incredible with this is that as Jesus is standing there, he's still wounded. The wounds are still present in his body. It's another reminder of prophecy. By his wounds, we will be healed. And with Thomas has this opportunity to really see them, to touch them if need be. You see, the victor is still scarred. The victor is still wounded. Friends, I find this really beautiful because we can have this expectation that as victors, that we don't bear scars. Maybe that's just me, but I think it's out there. That in victory, we're going to be perfectly perfect. We're not joining celebration parade, are we? We're just the same as the disciples. We're living a continued human existence. We believe in Jesus. We're following after Christ, and yet we're still scarred. We're still scared. We're in our homes because we can get sick. Jesus is wounded, and we have this picture to hold on to. And it doesn't always make sense. It can be hard to really grab hold of that, to resonate with that. I have some physical scars that I would rather keep hidden. It's something that we try to do, isn't it? There's something over the last few years that I've been connecting with that has helped me think through this process. Some of you who have been with me for a while here at Gateway will be familiar with this. Some of you, it may be your first time hearing this, but I want to share with you a picture. This is a plate. It's a plate that has been broken. And this is not a true kintsugi repair, but it's what we could do. Kintsugi is an ancient Japanese art form, and it is an art form of, in a sense, repairing broken pottery, teacups. And so it came out of ancient Japan, of repairing teacups that were broken. It is a really incredible and beautiful art form, and there's a lot of symbolism in it that we can connect with. And it's been personally helping me over the last couple of years, and really through these last several weeks. But if you really look at it, what you can see is that the scars, the break, is not hidden. In fact, it's magnified. Now, in true Japanese kintsugi, what they'll do is they'll take a Japanese lacquer and real gold, and they will repair the break with this lacquer and gold. And what it does is that it makes whatever the vessel was, in fact, be more valuable than it was before the break. Now, it can be easy for us to use a word with this, and the word is fix. This plate, we could say, this plate has been fixed, but that is not really, in fact, the right word or the right mentality to have when it comes to kintsugi. Because with kintsugi, what the thought behind it is that this is now made new. It is not the same. It is something new and more valuable. What Scripture tells us, I think, it doesn't say this exactly about Jesus, but I think we can get there, is that by Jesus coming back alive, Jesus wasn't fixed, you see. And by us following Jesus, believing in Jesus, what Scripture says is that we are not fixed, but we are made new. We are new creatures. We are new creations. This holds universal implications, eternal implications for us. And I think it helps us. I think it helps us as we walk out of hiding, out of fear, out of an airplane that was a horrible experience. You see, when we debarked that airplane ride, there was no parade. It was just real life. And we walked and we picked up our bags and nobody celebrated us. Nothing stopped. Everything just kept going. See, Jesus came out of the tomb. He was different. He was new. For us to come from spiritual death into spiritual life, we will still be scarred. We will still have wounds. But we are made new in Christ. Our Christ. Jesus, our Savior, our Victor, the champion of all champions, bears wounds. If we can wrap our minds around that, it can bring us to a place, I think, of spiritual health and vitality, and help us in these moments when we lament. When we grieve, because we will lament and grieve. Friends, are you struggling? How are you doing? If you are, grieve. Speak openly with God. He already knows what you're thinking. Speak openly and listen. His response. Don't be surprised to find scars, sickness, sadness, grief. Because we will have those things. We're not promised a victory parade in this life. Connect with Jesus Christ. Let Him speak into your life. Let Him guide you. Follow after Him. Lament if need be. Praise as well. Spend time reading Psalm 88 if you can, and through the Gospels if you can as well, and see if it lines up with what you expect. Thanks for joining us. The worship team is going to come back up to the front, and we're going to close with another final song. There's so much to wrap our minds around in these times. How do we just live everyday life? How do we have some sort of normal existence? How do we be Christians in a pandemic? There's some answers. Sometimes there's not. What are we in need of? What are we in need of more than anything else? I think what we're in need of more than anything else is Christ. If we have Christ, then even as we're being scarred, we'll still have hope. If you're struggling, reach out, talk to somebody. If you have questions, reach out. We'll try to answer. What we're doing in these moments is condensing a whole lot of biblical truth and stories and everything, and we can't capture it all. And I can't do a very good job anyway of trying to capture everything that needs to be said. So it's not contained just to this moment together. We all need more time in studying and praying and talking with each other. Let's close. I'll close with a word of prayer, and then we'll have a final song. So will you pray with me, please? Heavenly Father, Lord, take this jumble, the mess of words, and help it to make sense. Help it to direct us to You and to Your Word and to Your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. Father, we truly have no hope without You or Jesus. And so draw us to this, but draw us to it in truth in a way that makes sense to You and that is wrapped up in You. Father, help us all as we continue to live in these times. Help us to glorify You, to honor You, and to be prepared for what You call us to next. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you.
Like a glory queen, I am. hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Thank you for joining us today.